Yes, yes. Look, and again, ladies, specifically, and gentlemen, you're in a relationship, before you even get a relationship, but you know, before you get married, let's just say this, but you know, if you're married or you're in a relationship, there needs to be signs. Look, I'm not gonna lie, Herbert Marshall's character was always at the damn rubber plant, like I say, where it's in Malaysia. So, you know, he's preoccupied. She's bored, she had nothing to do, you know, she's a housewife. But even if you're a 9-to-5 woman, you can, because Georgia, what you said, you are entitled. What about my happiness? What about my feelings? It had nothing to do that she literally had nothing to do except knit. You'll see that her and that crocheting, and that plays a big part in this movie, her crocheting. But you said it, when you feel that your happiness is connected to some other person's ability to concoct this world for you, you are heading for a dark path, and we see it in this movie. And that lawyer wasn't having it. You know, he was a lawyer and he was loyal to his client, but the more she talked, he was like, mm-mm. You know, and then the letter comes into play, and so Georgia, the scene where he really calls BS. And again, I don't know who won, Georgia. Maybe one of us could look it up. Our audience, you know, if you know who won that year, and if before we get off our podcast, I'll try to look. I don't know who beat Bette Davis that year for the letter. But that scene where she's gotten arrested and she and a lawyer are talking, the lawyer presents a copy of the letter, and and she denies it. But then the point, they're sitting down and he's looking her dead in the eyes, a stare off. And when she lies, I'm not even going to say what she denies, that she didn't write the letter. And the acting is so superb, because once she thinks, she gets that lie out of her mouth, she thinks the lawyer has accepted it, or she's not even waiting to see that he's accepted it. And again, the body language, and then she comes clean. I mean, I'm scared of people like this, George. I don't know about you. These type of people frighten me. They really do.
She's scary. And it, like, this is before she did all the things like the nanny and whatever
happened. Right.
It can be so scary.
Oh, it was because there are people like this who are master manipulators who lie to you. And so let's go back to Herbert Marshall, the saintly husband. You know, I'm not going to say this term. I was going to say it, but because I think it's a little mean, I would be picking on him. But he loved his wife, and he was the perfect husband, wasn't he, Georgia? He was absolutely perfect.
God. Yeah, there's a line there that says, you know, when you truly love somebody, you'll forgive them anything, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, you know, I just wanted to just pat him on the back and say, man, you know, you deserve a lot better than what you got.
Right. And so we're leaving out, there's what the fourth party, if you will. So the wife, played by Gail Sundergaard. So this is Malaysia. And of course, this is during colonialism, imperialism. So there's a lot of racism and what have you. And Bette Davis is really nasty, says some really racist and nasty things. The character, Leslie, says some really horrible things and such about this lady. But Gail Sundergaard and the other Chung Hee, played by Willie Fung, the great, I'm not going to say it's right. Ong Chi Sing, played by Victor Sin Young. He was the attorney's assistant and the confidant to Gail Sundergaard's character, the wife. So Georgia, did you see the juxtaposition of when Betty's coolness had to go up against Gail Sundergaard, the wife's coolness? And they played a psychological game of chicken, and Bette Davis damn sure lost, okay? In my opinion, she lost that game of chicken.
Oh my God. This performance by Gail Sundergaard Jill Sondergaard playing the wife, Mrs. Hammond, if you look, with very few words, she is seething with anger towards this woman. You've got to see this. It's brilliant.
Yes.
It's a few times, the very few times I think you will ever see Bette Davis actually upstaged. She really feels
You know, this is one of the few movies, Georgia, if you look at it, where the men are the victims. The men are the heroes in a relationship movie. They're the bad guys. This is one of the few where that's not the case, right?
I agree with you. I agree. This is where the women call the shots in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
And the men are...
Right.
Well, the men are controlled in this movie. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and there's a scene in this movie where Bette Davis, for many years, was in kind of a complete disagreement with the director, William Wyler. I think it was the only time she ever walked off the stage, but I want y'all to watch with particular interest the scene where her husband, played by Herbert Marshall, confronts her.
Mm-hmm.
And she says, she makes this confession to her husband and says, with all my heart, I still love the man I killed.
Mm-hmm.
And so as if that wasn't enough, Bette Davis said, no woman who really felt that way could look her husband right in the eyes and say that to him.
Mm-hmm.
And William Wyler said, yes, you are going to play it that way. You are going to say it like that. You will do it. So she did. She gave in to him. The only time she ever walked off from William Wyler, she played it the way he told her to. Many, many, many years later, I think it was like maybe 35 or many years later, some awards ceremony, he was there and Bette was in the audience. He said, you know, if Bette right now, if you gave her the chance this minute, would she replay that over again? And they panned the camera to her and she goes, yes. Yes, you would do it my way. Yes, yes. So, I will let you, when you see this scene, you make up your minds for yourselves.
Yeah.
Was Bette right? Should she not have looked her husband in the eyes, or was William Wyler the director right in the way he made her portray that?
Right.
But that's one of the key or most pivotal role. It tells you so much about Bette and what a devastating blow to Herbert Marshall this must have been for her to make that confession.
Like, the men were the victim physically and mentally. And I love how you brought that out. The women were empowered. And this is post code. This is post pre-code.
Yes.
And so, you were saying before when we were preparing for today's podcast, there was a lot of controversy and there was a lot of, things that they didn't want in this movie, the adultery and stuff.
Exactly right. They didn't want the adultery. They didn't want there was the murder.
Right. That's what we love about Bette. You said she became the character. I mean, yeah, but there's one thing to become the character, and there's another one to draw the audience in, hold your attention, make you feel some kind of way, leave the movie, still think about it, then look at your own life. So it took her, Somerset Maugham, and Wyler to do this, to make this movie so just stand a test of time and be so substantial. And on just a little bit more trivia, and I knew there was something about the Academy Awards with this damn movie. Ginger Rogers won for Kitty Frickin' Foyle. And that's why I cannot stand Ginger Rogers till this day. look who are the nominees, Georgia. Bette Davis for The Letter, Joan Fontaine for Rebecca, Katharine Hepburn, The Philadelphia Story, and Martha Scott for Our Town. How in the world? Who did Ginger Rogers screw to get that damn Oscar for Kitty Foyle? And I saw Kitty Foyle. I'm going to tell you, she got the Oscar because this was her best performance not being Ginger Rogers. That's why she got the Oscar. Because there is no, if you did this over, hell no. is it either going to be Betty or Rebecca or Joan Fontaine for Rebecca? Katharine Hepburn for the, I've seen better performances, but no way. Well, again, this was her first and last Oscar, her first and last nomination, talking about Ginger Rogers, and you know why. Okay, now let's move on. We out of the shade room. Joyce is like, oh wow, my.
I gotta agree with you. Betty was robbed.
She was robbed so many times. We should do a podcast. How Betty Davis was robbed. We might do a whole separate deal or something like that. We are running out of time, Georgia. Is there anything else left to say before we conclude?
Let's see. You know, they gave it this noirish feel, and you know the shadowy stuff that they did. They actually had these like shadows painted on the floor to give
that effect.
I mean, there was so much dedication made to getting just the right feel and the right setting and the ambiance, the whole mood and everything going on.
Wow.
Let me tell you, one of the things I want you to watch is at the very beginning of this movie, the moon plays a very prominent scene.
Yes.
The very final scene, it's the moon again, and what happens under that moon?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so be watching for that.
Yes, please. Excellent cinematography by the whoever did it. Perfect. Anything else before we get on out of here?
No, sweetie, I think that's kind of a wrap for me.
Well, yeah, we're going to stop because, you know, the more we talk, you know, we never want to give it away. So again, don't forget we're on Facebook at How Betty Davis Saved My Life. And again, this is How Betty Davis Saved My Life. Life lessons from classic Hollywood. We hope you enjoyed it. Please subscribe. Please contact us via the comments. Keep it clean. Keep it mature. Okay, we don't want to block you, but but we will. So I am Moya, and for Georgia, we want to say thank you again for tuning in to How Betty Davis Saved My Life: Life Lessons from Classic Hollywood. See you next time.